92nd Street Y Online Media is made possible by the generous support of listeners like you. This program features a speech by Governor Mario Cuomo as part of a panel titled, Who is God? It was recorded on October 15th, 1991, in front of a live audience at New York's 92nd Street Y.
Mario Cuomo is in his third consecutive term as governor of the state of New York. Born in New York, educated in public schools in St. John's College and St. John's Law School, he was an adjunct professor of law while practicing law before entering politics. He has distinguished himself as the governor and as a politician, not only by his ability, but by his willingness to tackle difficult, problematical questions, such as the one tonight. He still thinks of Queens as heaven, even though a bishop from time to time will consign him elsewhere. Mario Cuomo.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Roger, and thank you, Ari and Madeline, for two brilliant and inspiring presentations. I'm not surprised at their excellence. As a matter of fact, when Roger asked me to join this distinguished panel just a couple of weeks ago, I was a substitute, incidentally, I told him that I didn't think that I could add anything to the subtlety, the intelligence, and the splendid articulation that was sure to come from the panel as already constituted. Roger agreed that I could add nothing to those. He said that, as a matter of fact, however, he didn't want any of those things from me. What he wanted me to do was to supply another dimension. He wanted me to talk about this question: who is God in the context of political power? Or doesn't God talk to politicians? Now, that's a nice question. And because I was eager to come here to listen to all the bright people on the stage and in the always extraordinary audience drawn to the 92nd Street Y, I agreed to come and to offer briefly my impressions on that question, that relatively narrow question that touches God and politics. Not quite so personally, perhaps, as the two presenters before me, not quite so impressionistically, but I hope nearly as briefly. And I do it certainly not as a scholar, nor a theologian, nor an apologist, but as an ordinary New Yorker, yes, from Queens, from asphalt streets and stickball, from a poor middle-class neighborhood, a man who made a living, helped raise a family, and found his way, somewhat improbably, into the difficult world of politics. I do it as a person who struggles to keep a belief in God that he has inherited. A Catholic, raised in a religion closer to the peasant roots of the simple Sunday Mass practitioners than to the high intellectual traditions of the Talmudic scholars, the elegant Episcopalian homilists, or abstruse Jesuit teachers. The simple folk of South Jamaica, who came from behind the grocery stores and from the tenements and from the little houses on Liverpool Street, perceived the world then as a sort of cosmic basic training course, filled by God with obstacles and traps to weed out the recruits unfit for eventual service in the heavenly host. The obstacles were everywhere. Our fate on earth was to be the poor banished children of Eve, mourning and weeping in the veil of tears, until by some combination of grace and good works and luck, we escaped final damnation. Their sense of who God is reflected the collective experience of people who, through most of their history, had little chance to concern themselves with helping the poor or healing the world's wounds. They were the poor, the wounded. Their poverty and their endless, sometimes losing struggle to feed themselves and hold their families together had varied little across the centuries. It was a cold voice they heard from God on Beaver Road, next to the cemetery across the street from my church, St. Monica's Church, where a famous ex-jockey, one of the homeless winos, froze to death sleeping in a large wooden crate. It was hard to see God's goodness in the pathetic faces of the customers in our small grocery store, pleading with my father for bread and maybe some cold cuts, just until the next relief check comes, Andrew, please. It got harder still during and after the Second World War, where the best we could say about victory was that the new terror was put down for a while. And a gold star in the window announced that someone's son had been killed, his mother's prayers at St. Monica's never answered. It was difficult to believe that God spoke at Hiroshima, either. Who could blame them for feeling that if God were not dead, he must surely be looking in another direction? Vietnam didn't help, nor the terrible, terrible 60s. The sadness of the 60s was, for me, memorialized for all time in The Graduate. Where have you gone, Joe DiMaggio? Our nation turns its lonely eyes to you. What's that you say, Mrs. Robinson? Jolton Joe has left and gone away. And with him all the heroes. No more John F. Kennedy. No more Martin Luther King Jr. No more Bobby Kennedy. Nothing to believe in, nothing to grab hold of, nothing to uplift us. People weren't asking, who is God? They were asking, is God? And for some of us, the awful burden of disbelief became intolerable. The absurdity of a world without explanation was too much to live with. Our intellects pushed to find a rationale, an explanation, an excuse, anything to take the place of despair. Something larger than ourselves to believe in. And if the answer could not be compelled by our shallow intellects, then we pleaded for an answer that at least we could choose to believe without contradicting that intellect. It had to be more than just a God of prohibition, more than just a God of guilt and punishment. It had to be more than John Calvin's chilling conclusion that God loves Jacob but hates Esau, more than Robert Browning's cold and capricious Caliban. It must be a God like the one that was promised in the old books, a God of mercy, a God of peace, a God of hope. In the end, to make sense, it must be a God of love. Now, many of us needed so much to believe in a God that we were in danger, as suggested by the old sinner that Ivan described in the Brothers Karamazov, of making one up. That's how badly we needed it. But we didn't have to make one up. We simply had to be taught, and we were, by one man who was all these things, a scientist, a paleontologist, a person who understood evolution, a soldier who knew the inexplicable evil of the battlefield, a scholar who knew the ages, a philosopher, a theologian, a believer, and a great priest, even a great Jesuit priest, Teilhard de Chardin. He heard our lament, and he answered us. He reoriented our theology and rewrote its language. His wonderful book, The Divine Milieu, dedicated to those who love this world, made negativism a sin. Teilhard glorified the world and everything in it. He taught us how the whole universe, even the pain and the imperfection that we see, is sacred. He taught it in powerful, cogent prose. He taught it in soaring poetry. Faith, he said, is not a call to escape the world, but a call to embrace it. Creation isn't an elaborate testing ground, but an invitation to join in the work of restoration. God created the world, Teilhard told us, but he did not finish it. He left that to us. What an extraordinary reaffirmation of Christian optimism. Think of it. He left it to us to finish the work of creation, something larger than ourselves to believe in indeed, a whole world to work on. There are other places to work on improving the world than in politics and government, but surely that's a good one. So who is God? He is a voice urging us to be involved in actively working to improve the world that he created every way possible, including through government, because it is a world he loves so much that he made man. to enjoy it. This isn't an exotic view exactly. Until recently, most Americans, I think, accepted at least the idea that government was created among us, by us, to promote the general welfare, to protect God's water and soil and air from contamination, to secure decent care for those who can't care for themselves, the sick, the indigent, the homeless, to help people find the dignity of work. Until recently, our history had been largely one of expanding that concept, reaching out to include those once excluded, the women and the blacks, the poor, the disabled. But this belief in benevolent activism and the commitment of each to the welfare of all, especially to the least among us, is today, as we know now, increasingly attacked and ridiculed and denied. There's a powerful move toward a new ethic for government. One that says, in effect, God helps those whom God has helped. And if God has left you out, who are we to presume on his will by trying to help you? Hardly anyone today denies the ascendancy of this view. Some applaud it as a smarter way. Some reject it as abdication. But most Americans understand that today there is indeed more money for savings and loans, but less for saving addicts. More money for bombs, but less for babies. More rich, more poor than ever. We're presented with a choice. Either we swim with the tide and accept the notion that the best way to improve the world is for government to help the fortunate and then hope that personal charity will induce them to take care of the rest of us. Or we resist by affirming that as we hear God, he tells us it is our moral obligation to be our brother's keeper, all of us as a people, as a government even, that our responsibility to our brothers and sisters is greater than any one of us, and that it doesn't end when they are out of the individual reach of our hand or our charity or our love. Now, believing that we have an obligation to love, that's not a comfortable position to be in. It can haunt us. It can nag at us in moments of happiness and personal success, disturbing our sleep and giving us that sense of guilt and unworthiness that used to be so strong and that the modern age is so eager to deny. And it can accuse us from the faces of the starving and the dispossessed and the wounded, faces that stare back at us from the front page of our newspaper, images from across the world that blink momentarily on our television screens. I was homeless, the image says, and you gave me theories of supply and demand. I was imprisoned and silenced for justice's sake, and you washed the hands of my torturers. I asked for bread, and you built the world's most sophisticated nuclear arsenal. Teilhard, in just a few magnificent sentences, captured everything I've tried to say here about who today's and eternity's God is. He talked about the Christ as a personal embodiment of that God, and describing our opportunities to involve ourselves in the things of this world, this is what Teilhard wrote. We must try everything for God. Jerusalem, lift up your head. Look at the immense crowds of those who build and those who seek. All over the world, men are toiling in laboratories, in studios, in deserts, in factories, in the vast social crucible. The ferment that is taking place by their instrumentality in art and science and thought is happening for your sake. Open then your arms and your heart, like Christ, and welcome the waters, the flood, accept the juice of humanity. For without its baptism, you will wither without desire, like a flower out of water. And tend it, since without your sun, it will disperse itself wildly in sterile shoots. Now, to some of us, that is the echo of God at God's most eloquent. No, not an easy matter believing that God commits us to the endless task of seeking improvement of the world around us, knowing that fulfillment is an eternity away. But certainly better than the anguish of futility, better than the emptiness of despair, and capable of bringing meaning to our most modest and clumsy efforts. That's a useful consolation for any of us, and especially for a politician from Queens still struggling to believe. Thank you.
Thanks for listening. For more information on 92nd Street Y and all of our programs, please visit us on the web. This program is copyright 1991 by 92nd Street Y.